Welcome to the Virtual Church of the Disillusioned. My name is Jack Allen Willard. We're going to begin this video by playing just a taste of Elvis Presley, a young Elvis Presley, singing a classic ancient hymn, In the Garden. Enjoy it.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my the song of God discloses, and He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me I am His own. Joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Wow. Ancient hymn, many, many decades ago. You know, Fanny Crosby wrote a ton of classic gospel hymns in the late 1800s, and Elvis loved those old hymns. Hope you enjoyed that. The name of our video, Bob Joyce, Elvis Evidence in Rapid Fire, as rapid as I can do it. We want to go out in style. I wasn't happy with the previous work that we have done recently, and we want to really bring it all together. There is some new stuff in this video. Watch to the end. Pause it if you have to, because you don't want to miss the ending. It's very special. we have been doing this, as I say, since 2019. And recently, the response has been incredible. My email, jackthefairguy@gmail.com. F-A-I-R, jackthefairguy@gmail.com, has been blowing up. Great comments from people like Dave Mitchell. Thank you for the support, Dave. Really appreciate it. Nana's been in there, and a lot of other people as well. And yet, I think it comes a time to close it out. And I want to do it to the best of my ability. That's what this is about. So let's get right to it as fast as we can. Share some of the evidence we have talked about in the past, and a few new things as well. We talked early on in one of our first videos about the writings of Gail Brewer and Phil Acheson, the Phil Acheson report that also led to three TV specials examining whether or not Elvis faked his death, hosted by Bill Bixby. Gail Brewer, well, her paperback book was quite a hit when it came out. Everybody was interested in it. And it came with an Elvis tape. Gail, it was known to a lot of people that she was investigating whether Elvis was alive, whether he had faked his death or not. And during this investigation, reportedly, well after the funeral, Elvis called Gail Brewer. She was able to tape the conversation, and he explained quite thoroughly why he did what he did, why he faked his death. It wasn't to deceive or hurt anyone, but there were a number of reasons why he did that. The voice sounded very much like Elvis Presley explaining it. And As I say, as you can see, that tape came with the paperback. Gail, of course, talked about the body in the coffin. Elvis passing away the 16th of August, 1977, the very day I arrived by bus in Dunkirk, New York, to begin my broadcast career. She talked about the coffin, and many people had the impression that this looked nothing like Elvis, especially the later days Elvis of 76, 77. It looked like a younger Elvis, but Gail pointed out that the nose was wrong, the hands were smaller, and it just didn't look real. Also, there was a noticeable sound coming from the bottom of the coffin, possibly fans, refrigeration unit. We were talking about August in Memphis, Tennessee, which is very hot, but of course a corpse does not sweat, but a wax dummy, wax does sweat, and there's very little chance that you're going to stop that sweat when the sun is beating down on the face. So there was many reports that Elvis appeared to be sweating. This younger version of Elvis appeared to be sweating in the coffin. And Gail heard from Mae Axton, a musician who I believe is the co-author of Heartbreak Hotel. She had called Vernon Presley when, like the rest of us, she heard about this terrible news that Elvis had passed away. And reportedly, Vernon told May that there would be no need for her to come to the viewing or to the funeral itself because Elvis isn't in the coffin. He isn't in the coffin. He's upstairs, very much alive, in Graceland. And then he went on to explain some things. Tanya Tucker actually did go to the viewing. And she, like many other people, didn't think that that was Elvis Presley laying there. And she went to Vernon and said, Vernon, that's not Elvis. Where is he? I said, oh, he's upstairs. He's upstairs. We had to show the fans something. And then Phil Acheson did a report. He talked about some of these things. You can find this online. I wasn't able to find the full copy in my search this time. I found part of it. It's called The Elvis Conspiracy. I believe it didn't happen to 1992, if what I read was accurate. And he and some fellow reporters, journalists, did an extensive study on the topic of whether Elvis faked his death. And he had some of the things that Gail had already talked about. But he also talked about things like a green helicopter that landed, this is after the funeral, landed in the back lawn of Graceland, and a man looking very much like Elvis Presley got on that helicopter with others. And he talked about the fact that Elvis, at that point, was in the witness protection program. You know, one of the favorite places for Elvis to do multiple gigs, like for 2 weeks in a row, was Las Vegas, Nevada. And like the other entertainers of that time, like Frank Sinatra, they obviously rubbed elbows with the mafia. The mafia at that time owned much of Las Vegas. And so they all wanted to be buddies, of course, with Elvis Presley. There's no indication that Elvis had any mob ties in terms of being involved with the mob, but they wanted to hang with him, and he learned things, he noticed things, that kind of thing. And then later on, when the FBI was interested in bringing one of these mafia kingpins down, they very much wanted the testimony of Elvis Presley, and they offered him entrance to the witness protection program, as well as protection for his family. And he decided to go for that. He decided to testify. The Memphis Mafia, as tough as they were, weren't going to be able to come against the real Mafia. Elvis had to leave. His family had to be protected. And he did this not just because he felt the need to testify, but because going into the witness protection program would be a chance for him to start a new life. He felt like a prisoner at Graceland at this point. No life, trapped there, really. Couldn't really do much of anything. And he was in very ill health. He was near death. He was near death. But according to Phil, according to Gail, he was able to get the help he needed before it actually led to his death. Supposedly, we have heard from a number of sources that his new name in the witness protection program was John Burroughs, and that John Burroughs, with others, took a flight to Argentina not long after the funeral, and that man was Elvis Aaron Presley, and he stayed in Argentina for a very long time because he had a lot of rehabilitation to do. Everything had to be fixed. An addiction to pain medication, because he wasn't so much pain. You know, this martial arts that he did caused him a lot of pain, was a lot of the reason for his pain and other things. He stayed in Argentina for a long time. And when he did finally come back to the United States, that's when the Elvis sightings began. That's when they began. So it was all part of a very carefully crafted program. And one of the things that was mentioned by Gail was that in 2005, Priscilla Presley was interviewed by Oprah. And she began talking about Elvis in the present tense, saying that she had spoken to Elvis just a few days earlier, and then she realized what she had said, and of course, you know, she had to say, well, you know, I still feel he's with me, that kind of thing. And that is a slight possibility, but many saw that as a sign that Priscilla had accidentally spilled the beans that Elvis was very much alive. Obviously, going back to the gravestone, the name of Elvis, his middle name was misspelled on the gravestone. Aaron was misspelled. And the life insurance on Elvis, which was a significant policy, was never cashed in, never redeemed. See, so why wouldn't that happen? And we do know that after Elvis Presley passed away, his sales went through the roof. The Elvis estate made a ton of money. Everybody wanted an Elvis CD then. Everybody wanted whatever memorabilia they could get. So Elvis was worth more if the perception was that he had passed away. Now, we talked about the emergence of Pastor Bob Joyce, who is the current pastor of Household of Faith in Benton, Arkansas. And it was around 2011, I believe, with John Cook in place as his right-hand man, as he is, his right-hand man as he is today. He was preaching at a different church. I'm not sure exactly where it was, whether it was in Arkansas or not. They had like the wall behind him was made of stones, and they began loading videos from his preaching and singing onto YouTube. Now, when they did that, they knew very well that they were going to get a huge reaction from people all over the world. We'll talk about Spa Guy at the end. If the dream of Bob Joyce, as he told Spa Guy, was that God had given him dreams to preach all over the world, well, loading those videos on YouTube accomplished that and still does today. Far more than 100,000 people have seen Bob Joyce preach and sing. And after the first church that we see on YouTube, got a church in a strip mall in Benton, Arkansas. And people, even though the congregation itself, the local congregation, was fairly small, people from all over the world would come to Household of Faith to hear Bob Joyce preach. And they would bring very special, well-thought-out gifts. One brought a beautiful guitar that Elvis Presley used in the movie Blue Hawaii, and I'm told that when that was opened up by Pastor Bob well after the church service, his eyes lit up and he was absolutely amazed and delighted to see that guitar. And he was always good to the people that traveled and went out of their way. Many times people that didn't have a lot of money, he always found a way to bless them back because he's such a wonderful, wonderful man. So there you have it. People started coming to the church, and then eventually they needed more room. And now, as of this video, which I'm doing the last day of March in 2022, it's a bigger church. Beautiful. It's not huge. It's not a mega church or anything like that, but there is a lot more seating, and Bob preaches every Sunday and often on Wednesday as well. Bob likes to occasionally make jokes from the pulpit. He likes to play off the perception, you might say, whether it's a real factual conclusion that people have made or whether it's just an amazing set of circumstances. I have always said from the very first video, I have to say this again. I know people have heard me say this, but I have to say this for new people. I have always said that I am open to the idea that Bob Joyce is not Elvis Presley, that this is just an amazing amount of coincidences. And that this is just for entertainment purposes. The internet is filled with people that have pictures. People like a lot of pictures. We're going to have some low-tech pictures. That I'm still low-tech in that department. But yes, these videos are up. They're going to stay up. But we're looking to, you know, to finally end this three-year investigation, but I'm trying to go out in style, present as much information as fast as I can, a little bit of new information, and stay tuned for the end, because we're going to bless you with something special. It is just an amazing thing, and so what I'm trying to make the point is that Bob has benefited greatly from the perception that he may be Elvis Presley, and that has allowed him to be preaching the gospel all over the world. It wouldn't have happened. Bob is a good preacher, but he would have, you know, if he looked like the man from the Andy Griffith Show behind me, Floyd the Barber, Pink Floyd. It's a Pink Floyd behind me, Pink Floyd the Barber. He wouldn't have gotten the kind of hits that Bob Joyce gets to this day, March 31st, 2022. As I say, Bob likes to make jokes from time to time and have fun. One time, he was, talking about getting old, you know, getting old. Could he really be a man in his 80s? He said, I used to dance with my hips, you know, I used to dance with my hips, but I'm getting too old. getting too old. So now I dance with my shoulders. Now I dance with my shoulders. We've told the story about the man who came to a household of faith, dressed as Rod Stewart, had the spiky blonde wig and everything. And at the appropriate time after Bob had prayed, he stood in front of this guy with a grin and said, I'm going to remember you. I'm going to remember you. The man had on a full gold suit. Bob looked at the jacket and said, I had a gold jacket once. I had a gold jacket once. And in 1957 and one or two other times, Elvis was on stage in a beautiful gold jacket. I talked about a video. Bob sang a beautiful hymn. This is when they were in the strip mall still. And when he finished, somebody from the congregation yelled out, thank you, Elvis. Thank you, Elvis. I made note of that. And soon after I did, the video was edited. And as soon as Bob stopped singing, it abruptly came to a conclusion. The video came to an abrupt conclusion. So we talked about that. One of the things that is unique to me is the two Bob Joyce theory, which I think explains a lot. Recently, Jimmy Kimmel on his late night talk show made fun of people, I think kind of trying to tie them to Trump supporters that think that Bob Joyce, the preacher in Benton, Arkansas, is Elvis Presley. He showed a picture of Bob and said, he looks more like Kenny Rogers to me. Well, it's definitely the Kenny Rogers look that Bob Joyce has. But when you look at his face, he doesn't look like Kenny Rogers. I've seen Kenny Rogers. God rest his soul. We all know what Kenny Rogers looks like. No, it doesn't. The face looks very much like Elvis Presley. Now, people have often said, Bob Joyce is 69 years old. He's not in well into his 80s. He's 69 years old. Therefore, he can't be Elvis Presley. But early on when I was doing this investigation after the first Bob Joyce video, I started getting comments, people telling me that there are two Bob Joyces and you should look into it. And at that point, I said, oh, man, I knew I should have never got into this topic. I'm going to hear from the tinfoil hat crowd. They're crazy. And I'm going to hear some wild things. But nevertheless, I decided to look into this, the two Bob Joyce possibility. And, man, I was blown away. I was blown away with what I saw. I started to see pictures of the older version of who I believe is Robert Wayne Joyce. And now this is one that my friend JJB, check out his videos on YouTube. Just look up the Bob Joyce videos with JJB. He puts up a lot of pictures. He also puts up pictures of Elvis's or I should say Bob Joyce's hand. Elvis was known to have broken his pinky, and he has a picture of Bob Joyce's, I think it's his right hand, and it looks like he also has a broken pinky. Jose deals with the scars and the veins matching them up, and he's very much a believer that Bob Joyce is Elvis Presley. But I started finding pictures of someone who looked like Bob Joyce, but was really an entirely different man. Jose had it too. And this right here was one of the pictures that I found. Got the Kenny Rogers look going on, which I think the other Bob Joyce copied, the current pastor of Household of Faith. But look at the eyes, and you can get a clearer picture if you look this up yourself. That is not Bob Joyce. I believe that is Robert Wayne Joyce, 69 years old. Did he pastor in Arkansas? before Bob Joyce? I believe a lot of people have told me yes, but I have no proof of that. I don't know for sure. A lot of people told me about a switcheroo. They tell me that both Bob Joyce's have been to the church. Someone told me that visited from far away that they went to the morning service with Pastor Bob Joyce, and of course they got to chat with him afterwards. And there was a luncheon that followed the service. The man who came to the luncheon, the Pastor Bob Joyce that came to the luncheon, was not the same man. And it was amazing. They couldn't believe it. But it was the same look and all that. But it was obvious that it wasn't the Bob Joyce that had just preached in the service. I've been told this by more than one person. Bob Joyce likes to have evening jams on a Sunday night, not for the church members, but for fellow musicians. I was told by someone who's given me various tips and what have you, that Bob had been working on a new song, and he just glanced at the sheet music when nobody was in the room, and written at the top of the music sheet were the initials EAP. So do with that whatever. I have no verification for any of that. This could all be just an amazing set of coincidences, things that may not be accurate because I don't have documentation on much of this. But yeah, I started to find out that there was ample proof that there were two Bob Joyces, one that is 69 years old and one that could be considerably older, like maybe well into his 80s. Let me see. I'll give you some other examples of who I think is Robert Wayne Joyce. There's a picture of him smiling. Here he is. I believe that's Robert Wayne Joyce, not Bob Joyce, the man who calls himself Bob Joyce in Benton, Arkansas, but I could be wrong. And again, there's better quality of these pictures if you look online. One of the most amazing things that is part of this story. We know that Elvis served in the army. He could have gotten out of it, but he didn't. But he went to Germany. Pastor Bob Joyce has shared that he served in Germany from the pulpit. And Elvis went to Germany. And he had already met Priscilla, already kind of fallen in love with Priscilla, but you know, you need company where you are. And he found this very attractive, very cute young lady in Germany. And there's numerous pictures of them together. I'm only going to show you one right now. But you can find many pictures that Jose has up. Check out his videos. And of this young lady with the soldier Elvis Presley. What I have here that I'm going to show you is a picture of, there we are, picture of Elvis with a young lady who could be Willina Hattie, could be, and then we have Bob Joyce, far more recent, with Willina Hattie. Let's try to get this as good as I can for you. I thought I had eliminated some of the glare by moving the light. But you can find better copies of this picture. But there are many pictures of this young, pretty lady. who I think was at the time and still would be younger than Elvis Presley. We know Priscilla was like 16. She could have been too, I don't know, a few years younger than Elvis Presley. But the thought is that, yes, they were boyfriend and girlfriend. Then he came back to the States and he would marry Priscilla. But Willina and Elvis stayed in touch all these years, and that down the road in the state of Arkansas, Willina Hattie, and we have the marriage certificate, married Robert Wayne Joyce. You can't copyright a marriage certificate. It's public. We had it up at one time. You can find it. The Elvis Evidence Group has a copy of the marriage certificate, but they don't believe, I don't think they believe in the two Bob Joyce theory. I believe the marriage certificate is of a 69-year-old Robert Wayne Joyce married to Willina Hattie. And I was able, and you can find this too, able to find pictures of a young Bob Joyce and Willina. And then next to that picture is the current pastor of Household of Faith, Bob Joyce, with Willina Joyce. And there you have it. Young Bob Joyce with the dark hair and dark beard, and Robert Wayne Joyce, I believe, with Willina. And then Bob Joyce with Willina Joyce from a few years back. So people would see that young picture, and there are other pictures of a young Robert Wayne Joyce that you can find, and they would say to me, see, that's not Elvis. That's not Elvis Presley. So there's your whole theory gone up in smoke. Of course, you got to think about what you're saying. Of course, young Bob Joyce was not Elvis Presley. Elvis Presley was busy being Elvis, looking totally different. He was totally busy being the king of rock and roll, making one movie after another, and eventually would tour. But during that time, he was probably making a lot of movies because that's what Colonel Parker wanted him to do. And we learned that Colonel Parker, since he wasn't a legal citizen of the United States, that meant that Elvis could never tour abroad because Colonel Parker was afraid he'd never get back into the United States. And he also took a big chunk of Elvis's money. That's a whole other story. So we see that Robert Wayne Joyce with a young Willina, yes, they were married in the state of Arkansas. And the current pastor of Household of Faith, Bob Joyce, calls himself Bob Joyce. That's up for, you to decide what you want to believe. That's a totally different man. That's a totally different man. And Nana's Angels, she commented saying that she has made friends on Facebook with Sabrina Joyce. I'm not sure what her married name is. But she has made friends with Sabrina, but Sabrina will not admit that her father is Elvis Presley. And Nana, I think the reason that she won't admit that, one of the reasons, obviously she wouldn't, she would protect her dad. But another reason is simply that her father is not Elvis Presley. Her father is 69-year-old Robert Wayne Joyce. And we can look here. And we can see the wedding picture of Robert Wayne Joyce with just got to make sure I can find it. There it is. Robert Wayne Joyce with Sabrina. There it is right there. And if you look closely, and you can find a better picture online, than this low-tech way. I don't believe, you look in his eyes again, that is not Bob Joyce that preaches every Sunday at Household of Faith. That is Robert Wayne Joyce with his daughter, Sabrina. Yes, the Kenny Rogers look and all that. And as Robert Wayne Joyce grew older, he did look more like Elvis Presley. But when you put them side by side, you can tell it's two different men. That's what I believe. That's my personal opinion. I could be wrong. We're examining a plethora of coincidences here, and we're going to move right along. I don't want this to be too long. Yes, there appears to be grainy video of Bob Joyce at Graceland. That's up on YouTube as well, when he was a little heavier. And some say it is also his daughter that we see, his real daughter that we see in the video with him. And then he gets in a black SUV eventually, goes up and down the stairs a few times, and he's chauffeured off, but we are able to see him fairly clearly. Now, there's reports of, you know, this guy who appears to be the groundsman at Graceland, and they say, oh, there's Elvis, that's Elvis Presley. You know, that's probably the gardener who also adapted the Kenny Rogers look, adapted whatever the Kenny Rogers look. And but when you look closely, that doesn't look like Elvis Presley at all. So a lot of people have fun with those kind of things. The thing that got me into the Daily Star in the UK twice was noticing that it appeared that Bob Joyce, the pastor from Benton, Arkansas, attended the funeral of George Klein in Memphis, Tennessee. George had been a legend in Memphis, playing Elvis on the radio and many other artists on AM. Is it AM 60 or AM 55, a big station in Memphis where they air the Grand Ole Opry. George was on there, and then Sirius XM came along, and they wanted to have an Elvis channel, and they had to have George Klein. They built a studio right across from Graceland, and George Klein was on there for many years. But he and Elvis had become friends very early on in the 60s, I guess, and Elvis called George Klein his best friend. We told the story in all the videos about George getting a call from Elvis saying, can you come down to the Cadillac dealership? I want to talk to you about something. And he said, sure, E. That's what they called him. Sure, E. I'll come down. I'll come down. When he did, Elvis and the Memphis Mafia were standing by a beautiful classic Cadillac. We used to make beautiful cars, remember, with a white interior. Elvis handed George the keys to the car and said, that's for you, buddy. That's for you. He was just a generous, lovely man. He was a flawed man, a sinner like all of us, but he was a wonderful, wonderful man back then. And he gave a Cadillac to his mom and many people he gave gifts to, including expensive watches. So there you have that. And George lived a long life. He was on Sirius XM for a long time, but then came the time a few years ago that he passed away, and many people that study Bob Joyce wondered, would Bob Joyce go to George Klein's funeral? There was the temple. Oh, I'm not sure if they were in a separate auditorium because it was huge, or this was actually the Jewish temple. A temple video that used mostly wide shots and then would come in close to the altar when people would speak. And then there was a woman named Judy Smith who, Judy, I know I'm not sure of the last name, Judy, got the view from the pew, and she was able to capture the back of the head of a man sitting in the front, in the left side of the auditorium, who looked very much like Bob Joyce, and next to him appeared to be Matt Joyce, the supposed son of Elvis, the supposed son of Bob Joyce. And Priscilla Presley was in attendance. In fact, she was sitting very close to Bob, a few rows behind. And the rabbi wanted Priscilla to come up and speak. She was reluctant. She was shy, but she did. She came up and she spoke. We have a picture of that as well. And, you know, she loved George as well. And she did speak. And there's a picture that you can't see very well of George Klein and his wife. But she spoke. And then when she came back down to go to her seat, in fact, she was just one row behind the man with the white hair. When she went behind the man with the white hair, she touched him on the shoulder and went back to her seat. So noticing these things got me into the Daily Star twice. They contacted me and asked me if they could use some of my video. I think it was the Bob Joyce Elvis Factor, or it was one prior to that. Now that I think about it, might have been reasons why Bob Joyce may be Elvis. She wanted to know if they could use that. They would fully credit me, and they would run a story in the newspaper as well. And I was certainly okay for that to happen. And let's see here. So it's still up on the Daily Star website. The video of Priscilla, she's already finished speaking, and then you see a little bit of my video. I guess it was the Bob Joyce Elvis Factor. And I think I've got the right one here. And make sure I got the correct one for you. This should be it. She spoke, and then she went to her seat. I'm trying to get that so you could actually hear it. Anyway, I come on, and they show a brief clip of my video, and they called me an Elvis conspiracy theorist. That was the first time I had ever been called that. And other people talked about what appeared to be the appearance of Bob Joyce at the George Klein funeral. Judy, who did the video in the auditorium, tried to take video of the gravesite, and she was quickly told by security, there'll be no videos here. I don't think anybody wanted her to capture potentially Bob Joyce going to pay his final respects to George Klein at the gravesite. She was told, no, no, no. Put that away. There'll be no video here. So we talked about that. And very recently, Spa Guy did something that took a lot of courage. He actually went to Benton, Arkansas, and went to the house of Bob Joyce and knocked on the door. And apparently Bob was there, and he had been napping. And he kept the camera held down, but he was recording audio. Bob didn't want him to record video, but he, you know, reluctantly spoke to a spa guy, and he was fairly cordial. And of course, spa guy asked him straight out, I think he almost said it, as I remember, you're not Elvis Presley, right? And Bob seemed to reluctantly say no. And then it was as if he felt guilty for what he was saying. This is just my perception. And then he went on to explain that God gave me a dream to reach the whole world preaching the gospel. He gave me dreams. We have said this in all the videos that when someone comes to Jesus Christ, and we don't know that the early Elvis singing gospel tunes had been saved, had a born-again experience at that time. We don't know that because he was also chasing gurus. He was investigating Buddhism, Hinduism. He, according to the Albert Goldman book, had a lot of sexual immorality in his life, but he was definitely into meditation. And looking at various different religions besides Christianity. But when someone has a born-again experience, the Bible tells us that they become a new creature in Christ. The old man disappears. Now, because of our flesh still being a factor, unfortunately, what can happen and what always happens is that the old man rears its ugly head again, and we are constantly having to ask for forgiveness and seek to truly repent. But Bob has denied being Elvis, did then on the porch there in Arkansas, and did from the pulpit in a roundabout way, never mentioning Elvis Presley. But the feeling could be that what Bob is saying, I'm not that anymore. The old man has gone. I'm a new creature in Christ. And if he doesn't say it that way, then every news crew in the world comes to Benton, Arkansas. He will no longer be the pastor there. And maybe he could preach to the world, but they would be wanting to hear him only because he was Elvis. And so he wants a totally different life, and he has achieved that. And I think that will continue. Certainly nothing we do here or all the other videos that are out there, many that feature pictures. Now, I realize when you speak about this and when you lay it all out, that it's more impactful. I do realize that. But we've been doing this for a while now, and the Holy Spirit has everything in check. And even though there has been a huge reaction to Bob Joyce, the pastor of Household of Faith, it's always been very contained. So I wanted to try to put this all together the best way I could and close out this topic with the best effort I could put forth. I want to close with another song. You know, if I were to put up a song, if I were to put up, say, I Can't Help Myself, Sugar Pie Honey Bunch, You Know That I Love You by the Four Tops. If I were to put up that Four Tops song, but change the name from the Four Tops to Jack Willard as the singer, that would get me in a lot of trouble, wouldn't it? Get me in a lot of trouble. I can't do that. That's not my song. That's the Four Tops singing Sugar Pie Honey Bunch, Can't Help Myself, all that. So I couldn't do that. So an artist, when he puts up a song, including Bob Joyce. I don't know if you know this, but Bob Joyce is on a number of different platforms. His music is available on Spotify, certainly YouTube, and other platforms. And he has a number of gospel tunes, another old one from ancient times. You know, Fanny Crosby wrote many hymns. He Hideth My Soul was one of them. And on Spotify and other platforms, the singer here is listed as Bob Joyce. We're going to play some of that song for you as we close. I want to say thank you for all your response. Continue to respond here. We'll keep this up for a while, and then let's be done with this. But we'll close with this song right here. I wish God's blessing on your life. As we seek him and put him first, that's when the blessings flow. As I say today, it's not God bless America, it's God convict America. We have more exciting videos that'll be coming up. We have a video right now up on the Last Days radio show, something that we hope to be doing soon on an internet radio station, my project that I hope the Lord is guiding and is the author of. And also a video that poses the question, if Trump had been reelected, would Putin have invaded the Ukraine? That's a good video. Watch that one as well. Please recommend the videos. Please like them if you like them. And share them, all right? We'll talk to you real soon. So let's hear Bob Joyce singing He Hideth My Soul.
Savior is Jesus my Lord. A wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depth love and covers me there with his hand, and covers me there with his hand.
We'll talk to you soon.